The House of Four by Barbara Nadel, read by Sean Barrett. Another day, another torment. The old woman was going mad and had lately taken to following her around the house, talking nonsense at her. Cleaning the toilets was bad enough without having her raving on about voices in the walls. But a job was a job, and as Bilal always said, maybe Fatima Hanum would leave her something when she died. She'd told him he was living in a fantasy, if he thought that. The old witch was mean as well as wicked. Celine opened the apartment door and went inside. Most of her employer's possessions made her shudder anyway. Who would want massive, faded sofas stuffed with ancient horsehair? She actually hoped they weren't going to come her way when Fatima Hanum died. Although she did like the old woman's dressing table, which was made entirely of gilded glass. She had a notion it was French, although it was more likely German, because that was where Fatima Hanum's father had been born. Mercifully, the apartment was quiet, which meant that Fatima Hanum was probably still asleep. Celine went straight to the kitchen and put the kettle on for tea. As usual, every surface was covered with the detritus the old woman left in her wake whenever she tried to cater for herself. Cheese uncovered by the sink, a half-sliced onion, broken biscuit scattered on the floor and round the waste bin. What she really needed was live-in help, but that wasn't going to happen. No one in their right mind would actually want to sleep in that awful, rotting building. It was bad enough visiting almost every day. Waiting for the kettle to boil, Celine had a cigarette. Bilal had forbidden smoking ever since he'd become a member of the AK party, and so she had to get her cigarettes in where she could. The old woman didn't mind. In fact, she sometimes smoked too. It felt good to have a quiet smoke after a whole weekend of abstinence. Bilal had made them all go to a party rally, even the kids, and Celine had been required to be on her best behaviour. Surrounded by pious, covered women, she'd felt completely out of her depth. Bilal reckoned it was because she wasn't covered. She knew he wanted her to cover, but she wasn't going to do it. She hated covering. There was still no movement from the old woman's room. Celine made the tea, and while she waited for it to brew, she had another cigarette. The smoke helped to keep at bay the smell of old person, which was strong on this occasion. But then it always was when Fatima Hanum had been alone all weekend. A fucking mosquito! Ali Baikal winced. With a pile of folded quilliams on his head, he couldn't very well stop and scratch where the bastard had bitten him. And it hurt! If only he'd worn that awful jacket his mother had tried to get him into, maybe he wouldn't have been bitten. The tiniest vest in the world just didn't do the job when it came to determined insects. But it was as hot as a kettle in the Grand Bazaar in July, and also, girls didn't like boys who wore their father's jackets, especially when their father had been dead for 10 years. People were looking at him now. Was he pulling a face as he tried to deal with the pain? It was getting worse. What kind of mosquito had attacked him? It was agony. Ali put his bundle down. He'd have to take a look. A man came over to him and said, "What's happened?" He put a hand on Ali's shoulder. "I've been bitten," he replied.
"Bitten?"
"Yes." Ali looked down, and it was then that he saw blood pumping out of his side, running down his vest and into his sweatpants. Suddenly he felt very weak. Chapter 1. The cleaner's name was Celine Inge, a plain, uncovered woman in her 40s. She kept saying that she hadn't done anything wrong, and Chetin Ikmen tended to believe her.
"Bilal is always saying that bad things will happen unless I cover," she said as she visibly trembled. Only the cigarette between her fingers was holding her up.
Inspector Chetin Ikmen of the Istanbul police led her towards a dusty sofa and made her sit down.
"I don't think your employer's death has anything to do with your choice of clothes," he said. Away in the largest bedroom of what was a vast 19th century apartment,
The department's pathologist, Dr. Arto Sarkisian, was already at work on the corpse of a very old woman. But it was only a formality. The blood-soaked hole in her chest left little doubt as to the cause of death of Miss Fatima Rudolfulu. Ikmen sat down opposite Selin Inger. From there, he could also watch his officers as they began to search for the bladed instrument that had killed the old woman. Have you seen anyone hanging around the building in the last few days?
No. People don't come here anymore. Haven't done for years. Only me and Mr. Yücel's man, Osman.
Ikmen frowned. Mr. Yücel's man? Who's Mr. Yücel?
He's Fatima Hanum's brother. He lives on the ground floor. Osman does odd jobs for him, shopping and things.
Ikmen had been having a wonderful breakfast of heavily sweetened Turkish coffee and three cigarettes at his desk when he'd got the call to an address on the Asian side of the city. All he knew about the district of Moda was that it was fashionable and expensive, although close to the old disused Moda ferry stage, which he had visited as a child 50 years ago, the huge Ottoman house that contained Fatima Hanum's apartment was unknown to him.
So, does this brother know?
Oh, no, she said. They didn't speak. None of them do.
Finding the unnamed alleyway between a coffee shop and a fashion house that led to number 130 Moda Caddesi had been a mission in itself. Unearthing the mansion behind its protective curtain of bindweed, ivy, and rotting garden furniture had challenged Ikmen and his officers still further. The pathologist, Dr. Sarkisian, who had been obliged to park his car down near the ferry stage, had arrived exhausted. And now there was not only a dead woman, but an uncommunicative brother, too. And what had the cleaner meant when she'd talked about none of them? None of whom? She put one cigarette out and lit another. Ikmen saw little hope for Selin Inger as a modest, covered woman.
Mr. Yücel, Mr. Kanat, and Mr. Kemal, she said. They don't speak, any of them.
And Mr. Yücel is Fatima Hanum's brother.
And Mr. Kanat and Mr. Kemal, she said. There are four siblings. They all live in this building, in different apartments. But they've not spoken to each other in my lifetime. Probably not in yours, either.
Ikmen had been born and brought up on the Asian side of the city, in the working-class district of Üsküdar. Now that he lived in the European part, he, in common with most Europe dwellers, rarely ventured to this side of the Bosphorus. It was a whole other world, and this one in particular was clearly out of the ordinary. Selin Inger began to cry again.
You won't put me in prison, will you?
She said. Ikmen's sergeant, Kerim Gürsel, waved at him from the kitchen. Ikmen stood.
I doubt it very much, Mrs. Inger, he said. I'm sorry, I'm being cold.
Kerim Gürsel was a good-looking man in early middle age. He was also, to Ikmen's delight, a person of great initiative. I bought some cappuccinos from that cafe on the corner, he said. He pointed to a box containing cardboard cups on top of the cooker. I talked to the owner. He must have seen us fighting to get in, Ikmen said. Let's say he was intrigued. Wanted to know why we were here. I told him we'd had a call. Everything and nothing. Yes, but what he told me was interesting, Kerim said. Did you know that this house is called the Teufel House? The Devil's House? In German, yes, Kerim said. The dead woman had a part Turkish, part Germanic surname. But why call your house the Devil's House? Was it some sort of joke? Anyway, there's coffee if you want it, sir. Ikmen patted him on the shoulder. Thank you. Stay with the cleaner. I'm going to talk to Dr. Sarkisian. Yes, sir. The old woman's bedroom was pure French-inspired Ottoman. Ornate, stuffy, and in this case, filthy. Either Selin Inger was forbidden from cleaning it, or the task was too big for her. The pathologist, an overweight, slightly owlish Armenian, looked up. Ah, Chetin. Otto. Chetin Ikmen and Otto Sarkisian had been friends since childhood, and so they very rarely used formal titles, even in front of others. So, a stabbing, Ikmen said. Yes, straight through the heart, the doctor replied. One blow, no sign of a struggle. With any luck, the victim was asleep when it happened. She'd certainly taken enough drugs to make that possible. Ikmen had seen a tray with numerous bottles of pills beside the bed when he'd first looked at the crime scene. What sort of drugs? I've not made a full inventory yet, the doctor said, but so far I've spotted warfarin, various blood pressure medications, sleeping tablets, an antidepressant, tranquilizers. The diseases of old age, Ikmen said. We have this to come. Speak for yourself, Otto said. Some of us are already there. Both men were of a certain age, Ikmen coming up for 60 and the doctor 1 year older. Could her meds have killed her before she was stabbed? Oh no, there's far too much blood. No, she was alive when she was attacked, heart pumping away. Ikmen walked over to the old woman's bed and looked at her. Tall and thin, Fatima Rudolfulu, even in death, had a strong jawline for a woman the cleaner reckoned had to be in her 90s. She also had a thick head of steel-grey hair. Well, I suppose I should go and break the bad news to her brothers, he said. Where do they live? In the three apartments below this one, Ikmen replied. Apparently, they never spoke. Otto frowned. Only the oldest traders in the Ichbidisten, at the very centre of the Grand Bazaar, were calm about the closure. Mainly antique dealers, they'd seen it all before, and knew that to rail against policemen like Sergeant Ömer Mungun was pointless. He's only doing his job, a white-haired Armenian said to the Muslim owner of the shop next to his. Ah, young people, the Muslim said. So impatient. Events happen when God wills. There is nothing mortals can do. But other traders were not of the same mind. When can we reopen? A young Kurdish man thrust his face into Irma's. Hey? I don't know, Irma said. Ali Baykar's blood was still on the ground, and every gate into the Grand Bazaar was being closed on what should have been one of the busiest days of the summer tourist season. But that wasn't Irma's problem. What mattered to him was that a 20-year-old man was fighting for his life after being stabbed in the side of the chest. Also, although surrounded by uniformed officers, Irma was without the guidance and gravitas of his superior, Inspector Mehmet Suleiman, who was supervising the closure of the gates into one of Istanbul's oldest structures. That boy didn't work here, the elderly Armenian said. I know, Irma said. The young victim worked at a carpet shop on Sahafla Jadizi. According to his traumatized employer, Ali didn't have an enemy in the world. He was carrying kilims on his head, the Armenian's neighbour said. Yes. Ali Baykal had been taking the small flat rugs over to an antique shop owned by his employer's brother just outside the Ichbidistin. He needed them to cover up a patch of damp that had appeared on his floor. This wasn't unusual in a building that had been in continual use since the 15th century. Sometimes parts of it just gave out. Ah, here you are, Ömer said to himself as he watched a tall, elegant man move through the crowds of confused shoppers and traders who were now effectively trapped inside the bazaar. Ömer? Inspector Mehmet Suleiman's voice was as deep and dark as his fine head of thick black hair. The scion of an old Ottoman family related to the imperial rulers of what was then the Ottoman Empire, Mehmet Suleiman was spectacularly handsome, and he knew it. He was also, at 45, at the height of both his physical and intellectual strength. Sir, do we have any CCTV of the incident? Suleiman asked.
Mr. Gavorgian,
the Armenian antique dealer pushed in front of Ömer and shook Suleiman's hand.
My cameras may have caught something. Mind you, they are pointed at the front of my shop. One of mine is positioned towards the street,
said Mr. Gevorgyan's neighbour. He bowed to Suleiman. I am Devlet Turkoglu. I specialise in antique jewellery with a particular interest in Art Deco.
Do you? Suleiman had a way of putting people down without actually saying anything offensive. It was the tone of voice he used, which was, to say the least, dismissive. He said to the traders, Well, let's see your CCTV records. He looked at Omer. Any news on the victim?
No, sir.
The man pushed his way to the front of a large knot of shoppers.
When are we going to be allowed out of here?
His face was red and he was clearly very agitated. Suleiman turned what Omer had come to recognize as his coldest gaze upon him. When you have been questioned and processed by my officers. Yes, but unless you want to spend some time in my cells, then you will shut up and wait, Suleiman said. A young man has been assaulted. I want to know who did that, as I'm sure you do. He turned away from the man and followed Mr. Turkoglu into his shop. Umar looked at the crowd in front of him and then glanced away. They were hot, confined, and having a bad time. Things could very easily turn ugly, especially with Suleiman in one of his not infrequent imperious moods.
They're all out, Karim Gursel said.
All of them?
Yes, can't get an answer from any of their apartments.
Ikmen turned to the cleaner, Selin Inge.
Do Fatima Hanum's brothers go out a lot? He asked.
No, never, she said. They're all even older than Fatima Hanum. Mr. Yücel has a man, Osman, as I told you. I see him on the stairs from time to time. I don't know what Mr. Kanat and Mr. Kemal do. I've only ever seen them through their windows.
Do you know where this Osman lives? Ikmen asked.
No, she said.
Do you know his surname?
No, she thought for a moment. But I do know he usually comes on a Monday morning. The old people need help after the weekend.
So he may yet arrive? Ikmen said.
Yes.
Any idea what time?
No, I think he comes when he can, she said. I've known him to be just arriving when I'm leaving.
Which is when, usually?
1 p.m.
Ikmen looked at his watch. It was 11:30 a.m. What about telephones? He said.
What, them? She said. No, they never had telephones. Fatima Hanum wrote letters.
Letters? To whom? Ikmen said.
I don't know, the cleaner replied. I just posted them.
Gonca Şerikoğlu didn't usually leave her large house and family in the old Jewish quarter of Balat. Everything she needed was there. Her children and grandchildren, her father, her work, and sometimes her lover. At one time, gypsies like Gonca had only lived in specific parts of the city, like Sulukule, now demolished, and Haskoy, which was gentrifying at an alarming state. Now the Roma people could be found almost anywhere, including, in the case of Gonca's cousin Barış, just outside the Grand Bazaar. A copper beater by trade, Barış, whose shop was opposite the Bayazid Gate, was a man who missed little. As soon as he'd seen Inspector Mehmet Suleiman supervising the sealing of the bazaar's gates, he'd called his cousin.
Mehmet Efendi is closing the bazaar, he had said, using Suleiman's princely title. Such power that man has!
Gonca had been compelled to see that. Standing in the middle of a huddle of pious, black-clad women, she looked like a multicoloured statue of Venus, with her ankle-length hair and low-cut summer dress in many shades of red, green, and orange. The women looked at her with suspicion, especially when Barış, a tiny stick of a man, ran up and kissed her.
Do you know what's going on? She asked.
Barış led her away from the women and into his shop.
Word is that a boy has been stabbed, he said.
Where? In the bazaar?
Yes.
Was there a fight? Was it carpet man?
According to my friend, Sarkis Bey, the boy works in a carpet shop, yes, Barış said. But there was no fight. The stabbing happened right outside Sarkis Bey's shop. So far, the boy lives.
Did the police have the person who did this?
Not as far as I know. It's why they've shut the bazaar.
After taking tea with her cousin, Gonja went outside and once again found herself in amongst the covered women. They talked about how unsafe the city was becoming and complained about the police.
They just swagger about looking down their noses at people, one woman said.
Another shook her head. My husband works in the bazaar. Who knows what this will do to his business?
Who was that man closing all the gates? Was he a policeman?
Gonja smiled. She wanted to say, yes, he is a policeman, and he's all mine. But she didn't. The covered women wouldn't be impressed, or rather, they wouldn't show that they were impressed. Had they seen her Mehmet, even they, surely, would feel some sort of sexual stirring. Gonja knew that she did. She sent her lover a text to let him know that when his day finished, she would be waiting for him. And because she was beautiful and because she had bewitched him, Gonja knew that Mehmet Suleiman would already be hot with desire for her. Chapter 2. Some of the younger constables were itching to use the battering ram. Ikmen let them.
Oh, to be young and full of machismo, he said as the team waited for the order to break down the door.
Osman Babajan, Yücel Rudolf Olu's casual carer, had turned up at 1 p.m. and opened the door to the old man's apartment. Ikmen had found Yücel in the same position as his sister, face upwards on his bed, with a stab wound to his chest. Stone dead. Now they were preparing to break into Kanat Rudolf Olu's second-floor apartment. Commissioner Hürrem Teker, who had arrived after the discovery of the second body, said, "Break it down." The door was a fine example of Ottoman hardwood carpentry, but it didn't stand a chance against four young lads with the kind of muscles a skinny, middle-aged man like Ikmen could only dream about. Once the team had broken through, Ikmen turned to Arto Sarkisian. "A tiny wager on cause of death," he said. "How about it?" The doctor shared his friend's graveyard sense of humour. "If he's been stabbed through the heart, you owe me a bottle of raki." Ikmen scowled. "I was going to say that." They walked towards the shattered door.
"Ah, but I got in first," the doctor said.
"Are you on?" The two men shook hands. Teke was first into the apartment. What had started out as a single suspicious death was developing into something far more sinister. Kanat Rudolfulu's apartment was ghastly, filthy and unkempt. It smelt of urine and damp, and there were feces on the floor of what had once been an elegant entrance hall. Commissioner Tekir said,
"This is an outrage. How can anyone live like this?"
"From what we can gather locally, this family has been all but forgotten," Ikmen said. "The old woman's cleaner told us that no one has visited for years."
"And yet Fatima Rudolfulu had a pile of prescription drugs by her bed, so she must have seen a doctor at some point."
"Maybe they were just repeat prescriptions," the doctor said. "Didn't the cleaner said she used to pick them up for the old woman?" "Yes," Ikmen said. The door into Kanat Rudolfulu's bedroom was open. As expected, he was lying on his back. Arto Sarkisian approached the bed first and declared that the old man had, on the face of it, died in exactly the same way as his siblings. As Ikmen left to go and organize the breaking down of Kemal Rudolfulu's front door, the doctor said to him, "You owe me."
"I know."
Once they'd found the body of the final Rudolfulu sibling, Commissioner Teker said to Ikmen, "And so what began as a simple murder turns into something even darker."
"Ah, yes," Ikmen said as he walked around one of the most extraordinary bedrooms he had ever seen.
"And I think that Mr. Kemal, at least, had some very unusual interests. A cross between a laboratory, complete with retorts, bell jars, titration tubes, and a museum of curiosities, Kemal Rudolfulu's bedroom was an unnerving place."
"What was he?" Tekir asked. "Some sort of scientist?"
Ikmen looked into the empty eye sockets of a human skull and said, "Not exactly." The beautiful, chaotic, treasure-filled Grand Bazaar of Istanbul is over 500 years old and contains 5,000 shops. In the summer months, it can attract upwards of 250,000 visitors a day. Add to that the number of traders and artisans who work in the bazaar, and one gets what is in effect a small city. It was a small city that Mehmet Suleiman had closed off from the world. An Irish technician called Turgut Zana had come out from police headquarters to look at CCTV footage of Ali Baykal's progress through the bazaar that morning. A jeweller called Maurice Taranto had been the first person to realise that the victim was bleeding, but he hadn't witnessed how that might have happened. No one had, and so far, narrowing down the masses trapped inside the bazaar to a few possible suspects was proving difficult. Footage from outside Sarkis Gevorgyan's shop, where the boy had collapsed, was unilluminating. Turgut Bey, shh, go away. Zana was looking at footage from the camera outside a shop specializing in Christian Orthodox icons. The owner, a perfectly round Turkish woman in her 60s, was shocked at the way the man who had stomped into her shop like a stormtrooper took this rebuttal. Suleiman noticed the look on her face. My fault, he said. I disturbed him. Officer Zana had never been an easy man. A Kurd, originally from Diyarbakir, he'd come to policing via a range of technical jobs, including filmmaking and internet security. His working-class parents had noticed, when he was very small, that their boy was different and had spent every penny they had on his education. It was said that Turgut Zana had never dropped a grade. He was also one of the few people who could tell Mehmet Suleiman to shut up. Umemungun arrived. How's it going? He whispered to Suleiman. I've no idea. Umer looked over at the Kurd. What's happening outside? A lot of unhappy people, Umer said. Reinforcements? On their way, but the commissioner's left for a situation over in Moda. Serious, I'm told. As serious as a random stabbing in the Grand Bazaar? Umer Mungun took Suleiman's arm and led him away from the Kurd and the woman. 4 suspicious deaths, all the same family, he said. Inspector Ikmen.
A person in a black tracksuit.
They both walked across to where the Kurd was hunched over a monitor.
Passes on the right side of the victim. Turgut Zana pointed at the screen. Raises one arm slightly. There.
He pointed at the screen. Suleiman, peering over Zana's shoulder, could feel the Kurd's discomfort. He didn't do proximity.
Can you make the image any clearer? He said.
If I could, I would have done so before I showed you, Zana said.
Suleiman would have bawled anyone else out for speaking to him in such a manner, but he knew it was pointless. Turgut Zana wouldn't understand.
Is it a man or a woman? Umer asked. Impossible to tell, the Kurd said. A man or a very slim woman.
Probably a man.
You can't make that assumption. We don't know. Accept it.
Suleiman saw Irma's face redden, so he moved him to one side.
Turgut Bey, he said, describe this figure factually to me in your own words, please.
The owner of the shop whispered to Irma.
He's not right, is he?
Irma said, no, Hanum, but he is very clever.
He's very rude.
Turgut Zana said, medium height, very slim, wearing a black tracksuit. I'd say Ralph Lauren, or maybe Lacoste. There's a small logo on the left breast, but it's not possible to make it out. Shoes are trainers, but shabby. I'd say he or she was fashionable, that he or she had money if it wasn't for the trainers. People who care about labels have to assemble the entire look. This is either someone poor who has stolen or borrowed an expensive tracksuit, or a wealthy person in disguise.
Just using shoes?
Why not? He peered at the screen again. Anything is possible in an infinite universe.
Yes, but do you want my professional opinion, or don't you, Inspector Suleiman?
Of course, I then listen,
he said. I'd estimate the age at anywhere between 16 and 30. If we say this is a man, then I should add that middle-aged men do wear tracksuits, as we know, but they move differently. This person moves with the fluidity of youth. He's carrying nothing, so he either lives in the city, where he can get access to his possessions easily, or he is too poor to actually have anything. Sadly, apart from his footwear, he is really rather nondescript.
Colouring?
He's wearing a hood that is shading his face. But given where we are, and the fact that he apparently has no possessions, he's probably not a tourist. Statistically, he will be a Turk or a Kurd, so in all probability, dark. And he is with someone.
The figure on the screen looked as if he was entirely alone. The nearest person to him, apart from Ali Baikal, was a very short, fat woman wearing a headscarf.
And I don't mean the woman, the Kurd said. She's irrelevant. But you see that figure behind the man in the tracksuit?
Suleiman saw a very out-of-focus figure, almost a ghost.
Yes? Well, if you look at the footage from outside the shop where the victim fell, you can see that this figure here and our tracksuited person are walking together, talking. I'd say that this...
Accomplice?
Accomplice is taller. Probably male, but again, I can't be sure. He or she is wearing a grey hooded top and blue jeans.
So two men, Suleiman said.
Or two women, or one of each, said the Kurd. I really can't definitively gender either of them.
Alchemy, Commissioner Hürrem Tekir folded her arms across her chest. Seriously?
When I was a child, we had an alchemist in Uskudar, Ikmen said. I know that was back in the 1950s, but when you think that alchemy is probably 2,000-plus years old, it's quite reasonable to assume that it wouldn't die out quickly. I know of at least one man who still practices the dark arts in this city.
Yes, but alchemy.
I remember the alchemist in Uskudar, Artur Sarkisian said. He was Greek. My father used to visit him.
Hürrem Tekir, unlike her predecessor, Commissioner Arduç, wasn't yet fully accustomed to the occult layers of Istanbul with which Çetin Ikmen and Artur Sarkisian were so easily familiar.
Wasn't your father a doctor?
Yes, Artur said, but he sometimes consulted the alchemist when he didn't know what to do.
About how to treat his patients?
Oh, no, he said. About life. My father was a very sad man, you know, madam. I suppose these days one would call him a depressive. The alchemist was a very wise person. My father learned a lot from him.
And so this paraphernalia? I don't know what it all means, Ikmen said, but I can see that he was trying to synthesize something in these flasks. He clearly used the fireplace because it contains burnt wood, and there's a scorched retort stand in the middle of the detritus, probably used to hold a flask with something or other inside. Then there's a skull, what looks like a wand. He picked up a book from a shelf. Pentagram on the cover, written in Latin.
Arto held out his hand. Let me see.
Ikmen gave him the book. The doctor read, Theatrum Chemicum, The Chemical Theatre, by Lazarus Zetzner. He opened the book.
Ah, yes. Astrological signifiers. The Kabbalah.
Isn't that witchcraft? Tekir asked.
Sort of, but a more accurate description would be magic, Ikmen explained. Alchemy wasn't just about creating gold from base metals. It was also about transmutation of the soul.
And what does that mean?
I'm not entirely sure, Ikmen said. Becoming an enlightened being, something like that. Or rather, in some cases, other alchemists profess to use magic to give themselves power. Some interpreted this as consorting with the devil.
God, is this relevant, Çetin Bey? Tekir said.
Clearly tired of such arcane talk, she shook her head again.
It could be, he said.
How?
Well, madam, we have four dead bodies in a building where an alchemist once lived, a building that we have been told by local people is known as the Devil's House.
Just circulating the Kurd's description of Ali Baikal's attacker and his or her accomplice to the officers on duty at the bazaar's 18 gates stretched Mehmet Suleiman's patience. Separating out those who didn't approximate these descriptions and checking those who did was interminable. But the bazaar had already been closed for almost one whole day. It couldn't be shut for a second. The traders would riot. At 5 p.m., Mehmet Suleiman called his mistress, Gunja Şerekulu. "I got your text," he said. "I'm not going to be able to see you tonight. I'm sorry."
"Oh," she sighed. "You know I came to see you this morning. Cousin Barış called me to tell me there'd been an incident in the bazaar. He saw you. Sadly, I didn't."
He lowered his voice. "I miss you."
"That's good," she said.
He laughed. "You are a terrible woman, Gunja, which is why you adore me." She ended the call.
Umar Mungun, who had been waiting patiently to speak to his superior, said, "Sir, we've found a boy in a black tracksuit hiding in one of the workshops."
The 5,000 shops in the Grand Bazaar didn't reflect the overall size of the complex. Behind modern glass shop windows lurked cavities in stone, once used by the Byzantines, where carpets were repaired and fake designer handbags created. Even the roof concealed silversmiths' workshops, corridors full of clothing alteration specialists, and men making leather belts.
Suleiman said, "Where?"
"In the roof above the Bodrum Han, behind a load of junk in the back of a leather workshop. The owner says he doesn't know him."
"Has he spoken?"
"No," Umar said. "I'm not sure whether he can. He looks spaced out to me."
"Where is he now?"
"I left him under guard in the owner's office," he said.
The two men walked southwestwards from the Ichbidistin to one of the bazaar's many ancient caravanserais. The Bodrum Han was famous for its leather goods. When they arrived, they found a tiny, chaotic office space filled with smoke, leather offcuts, two enormous uniformed officers, and a small, frightened-eyed boy.
Umar Mungun said, "Has he spoken?"
"No, Sergeant."
A chair was found for Suleiman, who sat opposite the boy. "My name," he said, "is Inspector Suleiman. Tell me your name." The boy just shook. He had the sort of face that could have been 16 or 30. He was young, but it was impossible to tell how young. Suleiman looked at his feet. His trainers were shabby.
"Are you Turkish?"
Still the boy remained silent. Suleiman looked up at Umar Mungun. "Did you find any ID on him?"
"No, sir."
"He was very dark. Could he be perhaps a Syrian refugee?"
"Are you from Syria?"
Suleiman asked, but the boy didn't respond.
"A young man who works in this bazaar has been stabbed," Suleiman continued. "We need to find out who did it."
"I told him he looked like the offender, sir," the bigger of the constables said.
Suleiman looked at him furiously.
"Why did you do that? Are you stupid?"
"Then again, I know the answer to that question. Sir, if he does speak Turkish, you've just sent his brain into meltdown."
"Sir, oh, don't give me any ridiculous excuses."
He looked at Omar.
"Where do we get these morons, eh, Sergeant?"
Before Umar Mungun could answer, the boy let out a sound that reminded Suleiman of the noise a cat makes when it's calling for its mate. The smaller of the two constables pinned him to his chair with one brutal arm.
"What is it?"
"What?"
"Satan has started his work,"
the boy said. His voice was soft and gravelly, and it made Mehmet Suleiman's flesh turn cold.
"The Lord of Hell is here, right here."
He looked into Suleiman's eyes.
"At your left elbow."
"Hasn't that place been empty for years?"
Alijan Ablak was a man of indeterminate age. A fashion designer by trade, he had the groomed beard and smooth skin of what Kerim Gürsel would call a hipster. He also had a very nice apartment, with views of the Sea of Marmara on one side and the back of the Devil's House on the other. "No, sir," Ikmen said. "Four elderly siblings lived there." Ablak shook his head. "Don't know anything about it." "How long have you lived here, Mr. Ablak?" Ikmen asked.
"Me?
5 years." The apartment building had probably been built in the 1960s, but the decor was most definitely modern. Matte black and dulled chrome was everywhere.
5 years,
another far deeper male voice said. Ikmen turned in time to see an old man with a stick walking slowly into what the younger man had called the drawing room.
"You were born here, Alijan," the old man said.
"Papa, from the police, yes?" the old man said to Ikmen as he sat down on an enormous black sofa.
"Yes, sir, Inspector Ikmen."
"Ah."
The old man grunted as he settled himself.
"I am Bulent Ablak, this silly boy's father. With the exception of the 2 years he was married, my son has lived in this apartment all his life."
Alijan's face reddened.
"Papa, and that's 50 years ago," he laughed. "Contrary to appearances, I let my son decorate the place. Well, why not? This is my apartment, Inspector. Please do sit."
Ikmen sat on a large leather chair opposite the old man.
"You have to forgive Alijan," Bulent Ablak said. "In his line of work, they all lie about their age."
"Papa, you know that's the way it is," his son said. "Fashion is just like that. It's a youth thing."
"Well, then, fashion is a fool," Bulent said. 50 years old and going out to clubs with women young enough to be his daughter, Inspector. Can you believe that?"
He could, but Ikmen didn't say so. "Mr. Ablak, as I told your son, I'm here about the house next door."
"Ah, yes. I saw your vehicles outside the Devil's House."
"You call it the Devil's House?"
"Oh, that's not its real name," the old man said. "Don't know what that is. I don't think I ever have. Why do you want to know?"
"There have been some incidents inside the house," Ikmen said. Together with Commissioner Tekir, he was due to give a statement to the press in 2 hours' time. If he hadn't seen Alijan Ablak standing on his balcony looking at the old building, he wouldn't even have thought about joining in the house-to-house inquiries himself. "Do you see much movement in and out of the Devil's House?" he asked.
"I occasionally see a middle-aged woman," the old man said. "But if you want to know whether I ever see the Rudolf Fulus, the answer is no. Not for years. But then how would I know them after all this time? They are my parents' generation.
To be honest with you, I never think about them." "Any reason?"
"What, apart from the fact that they entombed themselves when I was an infant in a house that can now hardly be seen through the weeds in its garden?"
"Have you ever been curious about them?"
"If I ever thought about them, I imagined they must be dead."
"Are they dead?" "Yes," Ikmen said.
"What, all of them?"
"Yes." Alijan Ablak sat down next to his father. "You always told me that place was derelict," he said.
"Well, it is. Not if people lived there. Why, I didn't want to intrigue you when you were a child," he said. "You might have gone in there. Wouldn't have looked good, would it? Son of a lawyer breaks into house. Also, to go into it all would have made me sound ridiculous."
He looked at Ikmen.
"I don't know how you stand on such things, Inspector, but I was brought up at a time when superstition of all sorts was frowned upon. Ataturk's Republic didn't believe in ghosts or saints or any of the other supernatural rubbish our forefathers subscribed to. Pity they still don't."
The old man looked miserable for a moment. Then he continued. But anyway, that place was thought to be cursed. That's why it's called the Devil's House. Because its original owner was believed by some to be the devil. Alijan laughed, but Ikmen didn't. Why did they think that? He said. He beat his servants, but who didn't in those days? He was a pasha, so he could do what he liked. I don't really know, the old man said. My mother disliked him just because he was a foreigner.
What kind of foreigner?
German, Bulent said. He was seconded to the Ottoman army in the Great War by our ally, the Kaiser. Got that house and a wife out of it, too. Rudolf Pasha, Ottoman soldier, and father of the four old fossils who rotted in that house.
I've been told that none of the siblings spoke to one another, Ikmen said. They lived in separate apartments.
Yes, that's true, Bulent nodded. Why, I don't know. There used to be stories.
Like what?
I can't remember, but I do know that my mother thought the four of them were bewitched.
By whom?
Their father, he said. According to my mother, Rudolf Pasha didn't want anyone to be happy, and that included his own children. But then the devil wouldn't, would he?
Chapter 3. Lolling his head out of his office window probably made him look mad, but Mehmet Suleiman didn't care. He'd spent much of the previous night trying to make sense of the ramblings of a boy whose name he still didn't know. The black tracksuited youth was sometimes the Sufi poet Rumi, sometimes a fairy, sometimes a demon called Imri. By the time he called for a psychiatric assessment, Suleiman was beginning to think that maybe the boy really was some kind of mystical being. Not that it mattered. Forensic analysis of his clothes would reveal whether or not he was carrying any blood droplets from Ali Baikal. Suleiman lit a cigarette. At 4 o'clock that morning, what had been a case of violent assault had become a murder. Surrounded by his family, Ali Baikal had slipped out of the coma that had followed on from the surgery he had been given and plunged into death.
Whatever the question, suicide is never the answer, he heard Çetin Ikmen say. He looked back into his office. Did I forget to lock the door?
Yes.
Oh, God.
Ikmen closed the door and locked it.
Well, in terms of who caused the most chaos in this city, I'd say that you win.
He sat down. I just got to shut a few roads in Moda while you closed the Grand Bazaar.
Never again.
Suleiman offered Ikmen a cigarette. In the last 24 hours, I've been shouted at by shopkeepers, watched more CCTV footage in the company of Turgut Zana than is good for anyone. Ikmen lit up and laughed. Poor Turgut. He can't help the way he is. Maybe not, but then we had to take statements from some very bizarre witnesses, which culminated in what I can only describe as an audience with a boy who, by turns, believes he is a fairy, a poet, and a demon. I had to call the psychiatrist. And all this against a background of a bazaar full of people, all of whom had to be processed before they could leave. If you were to include statements, the contact details the officers took down yesterday would reach to the moon. I'd put money on it.
Oh, don't make bets, Ikmen said. I made one with Dr. Sarkisian yesterday and ended up owing him a very expensive bottle of raki. My gambling days are over. Where's Umer?
I sent him home.
Which is where you should be.
Can't. I've got to see Tekir at 10.
I've just seen her, Ikmen said. She's a little, well, stressed.
You know our victim died?
Yes, Ikmen said. Any idea about motive?
None so far. He came from a nice, ordinary, working-class family. Father was a railwayman until he died 10 years ago. Mother lives off his pension and does some cleaning for a couple of pensions in Sultanahmet. One older sister married with a baby. The kid was a normal 20-year-old. Worked for a carpet dealer, into girls, computer games and music. No hint of radicalization. Everybody liked him.
And you? What has happened in Moda? Four elderly siblings stabbed in their beds, Ikmen said.
Wow.
Mehmet, have you ever heard of an Ottoman commander called Rudolf Pasha?
No. My father may have done, but he shrugged.
Mohammed Suleiman Efendi, Ottoman prince and Mehmet's father, had been dementing for years. Once a valuable fount of imperial knowledge, he was cared for by his wife and Mehmet's older brother, Murat. He didn't even know his own name.
Rudolf was German, Ikmen said, lent to the empire by the Kaiser during the Great War. He stayed on, married a princess, and lived out his life after the war in the house he'd moved into when he first arrived in Istanbul. Our four dead bodies are his children.
Well, they must be ancient.
Indeed. The youngest, Fatima Hanum, was 96. Their house is an enormous late Ottoman pile hidden behind what I can only describe as a madness of foliage, hemmed in by 1960s apartment blocks. However, it isn't one house anymore. At some point, the siblings took up residence on different floors, which were converted into apartments. It said they had some sort of falling out. I don't yet know why. And hadn't spoken for decades.
Strange, eh?
Strange that you didn't know about this before, Suleiman said. I've always thought you knew every weird corner of this city.
Ooh, it gets weirder, Ikmen said.
I eventually found out that the house was originally called the Tulip Kiosk, but no one who knows anything about the place calls it that. It is said that Rudolf Pasha was a bit of a bastard who may have dabbled in black magic, and because of that, it's known as the Devil's House.
Oh, the devil again, Suleiman said wearily as he lit another cigarette.
Again?
The boy I called the psychiatrist out to told me that the devil was standing at my left elbow. He said, the Lord of Hell is here.
Did he? Ikmen said.
Yes.
Suleiman yawned.
Clearly mad.
Çetin Ikmen looked out of the window and up into the brightening morning sky. Another hot day in the golden city on the Bosphorus. And yet again, he thought, they were pondering on the nature of evil. Kerim Gürsel had never been in charge of such a large crime scene before. Çetin Ikmen was usually in control, but he'd had to return to police headquarters in order to brief Commissioner Tekir. And so, for a short period of time, Kerim was the boss. All the bodies had been removed the previous day. Now the forensic searches had begun. The scene of crime officers had started with Fatima Rudolfoğlu's apartment, and a lot of the old woman's possessions had already been taken away. Kerim walked back into the bedroom. Only the frame of the bed remained, the mattress and bedclothes having gone to the Forensic Institute for analysis. A number of small items had also been removed, as well as a lot of dried-out cosmetics and battered hairbrushes. The strange glass dressing table was home to many small boxes. They came in all shapes and sizes, some made from wood, others glass, and some of tarnished metal that might have been silver. He opened a couple and found sad little collections of used lipsticks, hair grips, and even a couple of teeth. What had this woman done with her life? Locked away in a house with three brothers she never spoke to? The cleaner reckoned that Fatima Hanum had become demented over the past few months. Why had it taken so long? Kerim knew that he himself would have gone mad under such circumstances. If none of the old people had spoken to each other within living memory, then something terrible must have happened between them. Did that thing have anything to do with their deaths? He opened a big metal box in front of the dressing table mirror. Very thin writing paper sprang out. It was like the stuff people used to write on to send letters by airmail. Thin, and so therefore cheaper to post. He picked up a sheet. It was covered in a shaky, pallid scrawl that he found he couldn't make out. Then he realized it was written in Arabic script. Sarah let another tram go.
It was already hot, and being rammed in with a load of other heavily sweating people was not an attractive prospect. Then there was the way she looked. She had decided to wear the burqa the previous year. Her mother had been horrified, but after Sayra had been on the Hajj, it had just seemed right. And it had pleased Adnan. Not that her husband had forced her to cover, he hadn't. But he'd been unable to hide his pleasure when she decided for herself. It was almost 11 o'clock. She was due at her in-law's apartment in Aksaray. She was going to be late. Even if she phoned them, she knew they'd be suspicious. Tophane to Aksaray wasn't far, and didn't take that long. But she still wouldn't get there on time. If only she hadn't missed the bus from Besiktas to Tophane. Her mother-in-law, particularly, would think she'd been up to no good. The tram stopped, and several people struggled to get out. Sayra pushed her way in. "It isn't Arabic, it's Ottoman." Ottoman. "Before Ataturk formulated the new alphabet in 1928, yes, I know what Ottoman script is," Kerim Gürsel said, "but why is it here?" He held up one of the old woman's letters. "Constable Kahraman said, her father was an Ottoman commander." "Even the children of the Ottoman elite had to learn the new alphabet, Constable," Kerim said. Kahraman shrugged. "Maybe she didn't. Locked away in this house. And anyway, how do you know Ottoman?" Kerim sounded surprised. Most people considered Kahraman to be a bit lacking. "I don't," Kahraman said. "I can't really read it. I just know it when I see it." "How?" "My dad knew it," he said. "My grandfather never learned the new alphabet. He was an imam back home in our village, and all his books were in Ottoman. Dad taught me the alphabet one winter, but I can't actually translate." Ikmen, who had been watching the exchange, took the letter from Kerim's hand. "How many of these are there?" he asked. "I don't know, sir," Kerim said. "The box on the dressing table was full of them." Ikmen handed the letter to Kahraman. "Can you make out the signature on this? At least I think it's a signature." The constable carefully traced some script at the bottom of the page with his finger. Then he said, "It's Kemal Rudolf Ful." "Her brother," Kerim said. "With whom she did not speak," Ikmen said. "I wonder whether she replied to him by letter." "The scene of crime have only just started work on the other apartments," Kerim said. "Do you want any letters like this kept to one side?" "Yes," Ikmen said. "They may signify nothing of any importance, but if Fatima and Kemal were communicating by letter, I want to know what they were communicating about." "You will have to get someone who can read Ottoman properly," Constable Kahraman said. "Yes," Ikmen shook his head. "You know, the only time I have ever seen anyone write using the Ottoman script was when I once saw Dr. Sarkisian's father write a note to his ancient gardener. Sadly, that was 50 years ago, and Vahan Sarkisian is long dead." "What should we do, sir?" Kerim asked. "Well, I understand that the government wants to put the learning of Ottoman back on the educational curriculum, but we can't wait for that," Ikmen said. "I imagine we'll have to call upon an academic. Let's see how many of these letters turn up, and then I'll decide what to do next. If you find any letters in modern Turkish, keep those separate." He walked out of the old woman's bedroom. Kerim sent Constable Kahraman back to his duties in Fatima Rudolfolu's bathroom. The boy was a living caricature. Raving, foaming at the mouth, and occasionally laughing, he was a typical madman. Commissioner Hürrem Tekke was deeply suspicious. "If ever I saw someone playing at being mad, that is it," she said as she closed the viewing hatch in the cell door. Mehmet Suleiman, whose ex-wife Selfa had been a psychiatrist, had thought that way too, at first. But so far there was no forensic evidence that connected the boy to Ali Baykal's killer, and Suleiman was now inclined to believe in the young man's madness. "I have to say that he looks genuine to me, madam," he said. "And apparently to Dr. Güven." Tekke shook her head. "Psychiatrists are, I have to admit, a mystery to me. Why do you think this boy is genuine, Mehmet Bey?" "Apart from the lack of forensic evidence?" "So far.
So far, he agreed. It's the way he looks at these entities he claims to see. All I can say is that I feel he really does see them. He follows them with his eyes. There's a communication. I'm no expert, but I've seen enough of this behaviour in the past to get a notion of what is genuine and what isn't. He was alluding to his ex-wife, but Takir didn't refer to Dr. Zilpha Hallman. One didn't.
You think the boy sees the devil? She said.
I wouldn't go that far, Suleiman replied. You don't believe in the devil? Takir was well known for her lack of religious conviction, but in spite of that, Suleiman knew that his answer needed to be politic. I don't know, he said. I believe that evil exists.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.